I was released from the war in June or July 1945, and we bought a small house in a suburb of Manchester called Timperley. It had a nice garden with a brook running through it, and I returned to the university and went into the room where my cloud chamber, which I'd used 6 years earlier, was there, still the dust sheet over it. So I pulled off the dust sheet and thought, oh my goodness, I must try to get this device working again. Well, what a change. I wanted a screwdriver, and there was no money to buy one. You know, a few months earlier, I could just pick up the phone and have a Lancaster Bomber delivered. The change was dramatic, but it was not the sort of life one had left before the war. You know, during the war, the pre-war life seemed idyllic, but after it was not. There's still bread rationing did not occur until after the war. Petrol was short. In Manchester, there was water rationing, and money was short. You know, money became important during the war. Money was never mentioned. It was whether one could do things, not how much it would cost. So I fiddled about some time with this cloud chamber, and then Blackett. He'd resigned from being the director of naval operational research, and had come back to Manchester, and he came into this room and said, "Whatever are you doing?" I said, "I'm trying to get this cloud chamber to work again," and he said, "I thought you were going to try this new method of detecting extensive air showers." So I said, "Oh, heavens above." Completely forgotten about during the cauldron of the war. And he said, "Look, go into the library, put the sheet back on that cloud chamber and see what you're going to do." He said, "Have a go at this new method." So I went into the library and a few papers I'd had, and I realized that in order to have any hope of detecting these great showers by radar, I needed a long wavelength. But I'd been working, of course, for most of the war with very short wavelengths, and for the whole war, 1.5 meters, and then in the centimetric region. So I did a few calculations. Blackett reminded me, I'd forgotten about the paper that bore our names. So I got hold of this paper and did a few calculations, and realized that I really did need a radar working on a wavelength of several meters, not centimeters. I knew J.S. Hay, who'd been with the Army Operational Research Group in Byfleet, and I know he'd been associated with the 4 meter equipment which had been used for helping the ACAC guns around London. So I phoned Hay to see if I had any chance of borrowing 4 meter equipment. He said, "No problem." He said, we're only too glad to dispose of it. It's being tipped over down coal mines because no one wants it." So he arranged for the Army to bring to Manchester a 4.2 meter, I think it was, yes, 36 megahertz. Yeah, megacycles in those days, but megahertz now. And this was brought into the Cooper Street opposite the physics department. And of course it caused an absolute sensation in university, because people in the university had been there all through the war and had never seen any big equipment. And with the army, a couple of chaps of the army, we set up this equipment outside what is now the Schuster building, and erected Yagi aerials on top, a diesel generator, a transmitter in a separate cabin, and then the receiver cabin with the Yagi aerials on top. So I eventually, the army had left, and I got acquainted with this equipment and with all the instruction books, and switched it on, and hoped to see the echoes from these big air showers. Well, what I saw was what turned out to be a mass of interference on the cathode ray tube. And in those days, electric trams were still running down Oxford Street and only a few yards from where my equipment was. Furthermore, they were extraordinary. It was direct current supply. It was all over Manchester and in university, and the trams were running on direct current. So I showed this to Blackett, and I said, the only hope is to find somewhere away from this interference. So a few days later, I met the bursar called Rainford, with whom I had much to do. He was then the deputy bursar, but he became bursar later on and became a very important factor in my life. And he seemed to be the only person there who seemed to have any interest and pleased to see one come back from the war. All the people remaining there had been busy with this piles of sand and buckets, doing their best to put out the fire bombs. And they were not the slightest bit interested in those of us who returned to the university after 6 years' absence.